Hi, welcome to the Fish Division. If I had to guess, I'd say you're all checking out these Westfest presentations because A, you're looking for entertainment, and B, you're hoping to learn something. Now, I want to entertain you with some education about Ohio State's fish collection, so let's dive in. Today, I want to show you some of the really cool fish we have in our collection and tell you why we keep all these fish. In our fish collection, we have 1.5 million fish cataloged with approximately an additional 750,000 waiting to be cataloged, that is recorded with information on where, when, by whom, with what equipment, and what were the conditions where and when the fish were caught. Why is that information important? Natural history collections like ours exist to provide access to our specimens and associated information to researchers that they can use in their studies. Let's take a quick look around at the fish, some of the fish, just a few that we have in this collection. As you can see, most of them are in trays of jars, in which case they're stored in ethanol. Some of them are skeletons in boxes, and then others are stored in the freezers, minus 80 Celsius degree freezers, like one of the ones back here. You may hear one kick on now and then and get a little noisy. Most of the fish in our collection were initially put in formaldehyde that kills mold and bacteria and creates links between cells that keeps the fish from getting mushy. Then, most are stored permanently in alcohol that prevents growth of mold and bacteria. Some are put in pure or nearly pure alcohol that is best for getting information from the DNA in the fish and then stored in one of the minus 80 Celsius degree freezers. Can you drink the alcohol? Yes, actually, this alcohol is the same as in the alcoholic beverages that we drink, so we can handle it without any problem. But for fish that rely on breathing the oxygen in the water, that alcohol is poison, so they would die if you tried to keep them in it. Can you drink the formaldehyde? No. Formalin is poisonous to us, just like it is poisonous to the mold and bacteria, not to mention to the fish. So we first put them painlessly to sleep and then to death with a sedative, like the anesthesia used in our surgeries, only in this case we use an overdose to kill them painlessly. We have fishes from around the world, but the largest proportion is from the United States, and we have the largest collection of freshwater fishes from one state, actually from two states, Ohio and Indiana. How many species are there in Ohio? Fish species? 160 native and 183 total when you include the introduced and invasive species from outside that are not native to Ohio. Why do we have so many fish species in Ohio? Because we have a wide range of habitats with our many rivers, creeks, and lakes, and flatlands, rolling plains, and big hills with fast and slow moving waters where different fish species with their different requirements can thrive. All right, let's talk about what sort of fishes are found in Ohio. Well, they're all freshwater because most freshwater fish could not survive in marine environments, and conversely, most marine fish would not survive in freshwater. However, some fish species groups, such as the killifish, an example I have right here, the golden top minnow, can tolerate higher levels of salt in the water and enter brackish waters for a short time, or even adapt to stay for good, or like the salmon that swim into the ocean from the ocean into lakes and rivers and stay there and back out to the ocean after reaching maturity. Next, we're going to take a look at the Olentangy River shark. There he is. You may be thinking to yourself, what? A shark in the Olentangy River? No worries. That species won't survive in freshwater either. But someone must have caught this one off the beach and thrown it in the river, where they decided against pan-frying it after all. Someone found it on the bank back in the 80s and brought it to us. The Olentangy River shark is actually a Atlantic sharp-nosed shark. The Atlantic sharp-nosed shark grows to just over a meter long. They're abundant in the waters along the shores of the Atlantic Ocean, from the shallow to deeper waters. They are often found in the surf zone, close to shore, off sandy beaches, bays, and in harbors, and in estuaries of river mouths, where they feed on small fishes, shrimps, crabs, marine worms, and shellfish. By the way, we have three Atlantic sharp-nosed sharks in our collection. The University of Florida fish collection, on the other hand, which has the second highest number of catalog fish specimens in the United States, has 179 sharp-nosed sharks in their collection. As might be expected, the University of Florida collection has a lot more marine fish specimens, but the Ohio State collection has some of the highest numbers of regional freshwater fish specimens. Also, all of Ohio's fish species are adapted to live in temperate waters, that is, waters that are not extremely cold nor extremely hot. Why is that? Almost all fish species are cold-blooded, so they can tolerate colder temperatures that would cause most of us to leap out of the water. But some fish species are adapted to extreme water temperatures, and most avoid areas where there are extremely cold temperatures. So fewer fish species live at the North and South poles, where it's colder. But there are exceptions, and one of those exceptions is the trouts. Trout species have the ability to alter the amount of salt in their blood plasma, which reduces the temperature at which ice forms in their blood. Let me show you a brown trout. They have light bodies with dark spots, but char like these lake trout, which are actually stained so you can see the fin rays and scales better. The char have dark bodies with light spots, as you can see in the picture. Trout are native to Europe in streams that flow to the Atlantic Ocean, while salmon are native to the Pacific Ocean and streams that flow to the Pacific Ocean, like California. Char are found across the northern latitudes of the Earth. Fishes that live in areas where ice forms on the water lower the freezing point of their bodily fluids, remember, by raising the concentrations of salt in their blood during the winter. Arctic char like these little guys, also stained, and were collected by Milton Troutman, whom we'll talk about a little later. Arctic char are adapted to survive colder temperatures than the other already colder water trout species by making antifreeze proteins in their blood. This closely related longfin char lives in a lake, in a crater lake, in a remote region in Siberia that was created by a meteor. What other astounding fish species do we have in our museum? Graduate students have brought us fish species from Lake Victoria, Lake Tanganyika, and other water bodies that border the countries Kenya and Uganda. Nile perch are invasive and extremely detrimental on native populations in those African lakes. They grow to a huge size, actually much bigger than this little guy in this jar. So you can see why the locals would appreciate their introduction so that they can have a lot to eat or they can sell them at the local markets. But the Nile perch eats or otherwise outcompetes out the cichlids and other native species. Speaking of cichlids in Africa, that group includes tilapia. Another favorite fish, food fish, they're introduced in areas outside of their native range, such as in South, Central, and North America, because they could not live in the northern latitudes. In the case of these species, they're adapted for warmer southern latitudes. Although they provide a good food resource, they are often detrimental to the local fish and other aquatic animals as well as plants. For one thing, they stir up the waters and just kind of pull up the plants and generally make a mess. This remarkable fish, which I'm unable to hold up a jar of because some professors have borrowed all my smaller lungfish, although I have some in a stainless steel tank with some bigger fish, is the lungfish. It is not introduced outside of their native range in Africa and other countries because they're not that good to eat, as well as not being easy to raise in fish hatcheries. However, their survival strategy is a wonderful thing to behold. When the rivers they live in undergo droughts, which happens annually where they live, lungfish can survive by digging a burrow in the mud and breathing air with their lung instead of needing to breathe oxygen from the water with their gills. Stonefish, you're going to love this one, from the area of the Pacific Ocean that borders the continents of northeastern Africa and southern Asia, like a few other species, fish species, have venom. The venom from this fish can kill you. Stonefish are able to mimic their surroundings to look like the rocks on the bottom where they live, using their camouflage to hide from predators. But if a predator steps on them, they have spines in their dorsal or back fin that pump the venom from the sacs at the bottom of the spines into the wound, much like a hypodermic needle. This venom will kill a human in 2 hours very painfully, unless they get the antidote at one of the widespread hospitals, far-flung hospitals that just happen to have the antidote. An electric eel is not actually an eel, and again, I only have one in the larger tank, not in a jar, but you can see the picture that we'll show. It instead belongs to a group of fishes called the knife fishes, again, not actually an eel. One noticeable difference between knife fishes and eels is the knife fishes have no dorsal fin. However, here's an eel, a moray eel, that some of you may be familiar with from watching documentaries on the ocean, or maybe even scuba diving or snorkeling near the beach. This eel does indeed have a dorsal fin. And if you were to look at that dorsal fin with a microscope, you could see the rays, the supporting structures in the fin that support the fin and help it to move. Now, this real eel has a dorsal fin with fins and rays that support the fin, but the knife fishes have a dorsal ridge, but no fin and no fin rays in that dorsal ridge. One of the ways that we can use to externally determine whether it's an eel or a knife fish. We've been looking at these fish. Now, let's try something a little different. What if we open up and feel inside one of the thousands of jars of fish we have here to understand what we have? Like this jar, for example. I'll open it up and take the fish out. Now, I can see the fish, and by looking at it, observe some of the characters to try to figure out what the fish does, maybe what it eats, where it hangs out, just by looking at those characters. But what if I were in the dark where I couldn't see the fish? Yeah, I know, I'd actually call a repairman. But let me close my eyes and pretend I'm in the dark. Now, I'm not really good at this, so I'm going to peek several times. I would use my other senses to find out about the fish, which is what this fish often does to find out about what it is going on in its usually dark environment at the bottom of the water, especially at night. Fish can hear. Actually, fish sense the vibrations in the water that come and bounce off their skin. They sense those vibrations and And then the nerves pick up the vibrations and they interpret the vibrations as to whether that something out in the water that made that vibration is staying still, as in an object, or moving toward or away from them, as in a predator or a prey. Now, smell. Fish can smell what is around them with the organs inside their nostrils, like humans can do. I'm going to use my nostrils to smell this fish. That smells like alcohol. Ah, but some fish species use these little whisker-like structures around their mouths and around their nostrils that are able, and with them they can touch and taste with the little organs on those barbels or the whisker-like structures, so they can figure out whether that worm or dead fish on the bottom will be good to eat. No accounting for the tastes of some catfish. Now, if I feel this fish, I can feel that it has eyes that are not relatively large, unlike some other fish species that normally feed during the day and near the top of the water. This fish has small eyes, so that tells me it may not use its eyes to see as much as other fish species, which also tells me this fish spends a lot of time in the dark, probably near the bottom of the water body. Can you guess what's that fish? That's right, it's a catfish. This species is fun to catch in our rivers and lakes, and most people, fisher people, think they're pretty good tasting too. Actually, one of my favorites to catch and eat, a channel catfish, which grow to about, yay big, depending on what kind of story you're telling, but really they do. Another of the catfishes today, catfish species I want to show you today, is called a mad tom catfish. Why, you ask, is the catfish mad? Well, there's a group of a family, actually, of seven species of catfish that live in Ohio, and the catfish in this group all share one thing in common. They can all sting you. When they get scared or maybe mad, they stick their pectoral or chest fins out that have a sharp spine at the front to protect themselves from being grabbed. So if you grab them, you get stuck with that sharp spine, and that will make a wound. Can you see that little spine right at the front of the fin? Let's see. Careful. All right. Ah, but there's more to the mad tom's protective strategy than just the spine. As we've already mentioned, they have venom that comes out from a sac that ruptures when the spine sticks out and spills the venom into the water and then into the wound made by the sharp spine. And it feels a lot like a bee sting and lasts just about as long. I'm a beekeeper, so I know. So maybe next time you'll be more careful when you think about grabbing that mad tom. At least that's their strategy. Unfortunately, you won't have to worry about grabbing this particular mad tom species, which I'm not going to show you an actual jar of, because we have just a few of them. We have to be really careful with those because they're extinct. This is the Sciota mad tom, otherwise known as Professor Troutman's mad tom, for the name of the fish curator that described the species, Milton Troutman. Troutman first found the mad tom in Big Darby Creek near Chillicothe, Ohio in 1943. And over the next 14 years, although he fished for the mad tom frequently at the same area as well as other similar areas, he found only 24 more Sciota mad toms. The last one found was in 1957. Despite Troutman and many others surveying for fish at the original locality, as well as similar sites in streams nearby, no more have ever been found. We've got more extinct Ohio species, like the hare-lip sucker. Again, I'm not going to take it out of the jar and show you because it's extinct. The hare-lip sucker was widespread throughout the Midwest and even on the eastern United States coast, but completely disappeared by the late 1800s. Many think this was due to pollution from agriculture that clogged their very fine gills and killed their favorite prey items, such as small snails and aquatic insects that were more easily crushed and swallowed with their specialized, extra fragile throat teeth. Speaking of throat teeth, All of the minnows and the suckers, which are part of the minnow order group, have throat teeth rather than jaw teeth. These are actually from a grass carp. The grass carp is a very large-bodied fish, grows to about 5 feet long, and they have these throat teeth that are actually very sturdy and can shred up, tear up, and grind up the aquatic plant species that they eat. And they also make a mess of the bottom, like other introduced carp species like the common carp. The pirate perch is actually a relatively common fish species in the Midwest and on the East Coast of the United States, and can be found in many areas of streams where there is slow-moving water with aquatic plants. The picture of the pirate perch and the Camp Creek Pirate Perch site displays some of their favorite habitat. And you can see the aquatic plants that they like to hang out in. Although the pirate perch was never overly abundant where they had been found in northwestern Ohio, due to alterations of Ohio streams for agriculture in the early history of our state, much of their habitat was destroyed, with the result that pirate perch disappeared from Ohio by 1950. But reduction of those destructive practices resulted in a recovery of much of that lost habitat. So when a reintroduction of the species was carried out in 1997, the species was able to recover to the point that they can be caught fairly easily today in an area where they had formerly been found. This fish species, the diamond darter, and I will show you, even though this one is no longer in Ohio waters, it's not extinct, but it is extirpated because it is no longer in the area where it was formerly found, but can be found in some other areas. It disappeared from Ohio rivers approximately 120 years ago and hasn't been seen in Kentucky and Tennessee streams for 80 to 90 years, respectively. Today, only one small population in the now protected Elk River in West Virginia remains of this once widespread, beautiful fish species. Hopefully, as our water quality continues to improve thanks to the efforts of people concerned about conserving our wild animals and plants, like you, this diamond darter and other endangered species that survive in small refuge areas will reoccupy their historical distributions. All right, I hope you've enjoyed learning about just a few of the amazing fish species we have in the Ohio State University Fish Collection, and look forward to seeing you again sometime soon.